Microsoft office in Moscow in Russia, so I deal mostly with business issues, and unfortunately for me, I'm not a scientist. But I'll try to talk about those things which are, on one hand, mathematical, and on another hand, are of some practical interest. Unfortunately, I have only 1 hour, a bit less, and a lot of things I wanted just to mention, so I will not be able to teach you anything or to tell you anything really new, and I will just try to overview several interesting things which are, from my point of view, are very interesting, but at the same time are not very often mentioned and vice versa often underestimated. That's an issue related to ethics and especially computer digital ethics in relation to big data. But it's not about, or mostly not about, how people should behave ethically while dealing with such a systems, which is also, of course, very interesting. It's more mostly about how we need to design systems, what techniques we can use to design systems to force them to be ethical and to force people to behave ethically while they deal with such a systems. And what at all it means to be ethical, to be moral in relation to such an information system. Briefly, map of what I wanted to just cover, or just to mention, is something like this. On the left side are various steps or scenarios or parts of scenarios related to big data. And on the right hand are some interesting mathematical or philosophical theories or attempts to describe something interesting. And I will try to map one to another during my presentation. First of all, motivation. Why all this is interesting and why should we care in general? As you've well known, and I think that for many times mentioned here, big data are big due to volume, velocity, and variety of them. And one another important thing is they're complicated in nature, and we typically do not understand this nature and the behavior of some components which form the big data set, or some rules that govern big data dynamics. Thus, we need some how to understand what to do with the data, and we need to find rules which describe them. And this can be really not trivial situation, and thus makes the behavior of big data a bit natural. Why it's important for everybody? Mostly because of its impact on business, social, and political life. It's a big opportunity for governments. Just mention recent decision of US administration to invest about $200 million into big data applications for government. Those who proposed this plan expect to save about 10% of state budget, a huge money, just from one governmental program with relatively small investment. So that's a big savings. That's a transparency and responsibility from the government. This is real insight into what society and how it operates, much more understanding about everything, and that's optimal decisions in general. A big opportunity for everybody, for all people. It's a self-organization of communities. It's a better experience. It's an intelligent environment, safe and comfortable. It's an introspection. It's a big opportunity for business. That's probably of interest, because what makes big data really very important, in my understanding, is some sort of instrument which allows business to turn any particular product into consistent, robust service. So what was an islands of something you do, say, one product, say car, or say film, or something like this, you may turn this into the process which combines a lot of other suppliers, your partners, your customers, all other bodies, and through all the information you can collect from all these parties, you can optimize the process and find much more ways to make money than it was ever. So big data is an instrument which helps to make reality a dream of most real businesses. They're becoming services. So technically, it means that you can extend value chains, which were initially concentrated inside the company, and you can extend it to ecosystem of partners and ecosystem of customers. And so add value related to the volume of your products and to the network effects of your products. And network effects, like collaboration between, say, customers, is square per the number of all customers, say. So new business models, education, and so on. And it's a big opportunity for IT industry as well, because it's a completely new world for us. It's a new hardware and software requirements. It's a new algorithms. And it's a completely new markets as well. But there is another side, definitely. It's a big challenge. It's a big challenge for people because of new and unexpected lack of privacy. It's a risk of automated justice when automated systems make decisions based on big data regarding your behavior, and in some cases can enforce some actions related to this. And you pretty well know that this almost started to operate in the case with, say, traffic control. But in some other regions, this can be very different. And you need to understand all these risks. It's a big challenge for business, because hard to comply with requirements. It's easy to violate something. It's, in many cases, unexpected reaction from society to what you are doing. It's a need to defend your sources of information, your collection of information. There are a few cases. Many, many years ago, TV renting industry faced a problem when one journalist came in the United States to TV film rent office and asked for the list of films which candidate to Supreme Court asked for some time. And reaction of policymakers was immediate. They decided to prohibit such an action. So this was one of the cases when receiving of such sort of data was prohibited. And now many other industries enjoy the opportunity to share information about your choices and your recommendations about something, but not TV industry. One another case when a retail chain occasionally disclose the fact that it can predict very personal information like pregnancy or something like this based on behavior of its customers. And the same problem, a lot of probably unexpected concerns which Google faced with its Google Glass. A lot more. And that's a big challenge for governments as well, because it's not very easy task to be transparent, and this transparency in many cases caused backfire from various social groups. And this is a well-known case for many countries, and it's a well-known case for Russia, where government had a lot of problems explaining and trying to solve the problems which were identified by volunteers browsing through those data which government published recently. And you know the same situations in the United States and so on as well. And this is a challenge, of course, for IT industry, because there is a risk of overregulation from governments. That's a risk of problems with customers. That's a risk of leak of data sources as well. And that's at least need to understand what to do. So there is a balance of pro and contra in the situation, but because potential value is huge, then we nevertheless trying to do and to solve the problems and to balance the risks and the opportunities. Computational ethics and big data. Why, in general, ethics is important for these things? Because systems which involve big data are complicated by nature. And that means that in many cases, our common experience will not be very good advisor in making specific decisions. But at the same time, we need somehow predictable or reasonable from most of people's point of view process of making decisions, nevertheless automated or monetized. So it's very important to understand why something is right or wrong, and it's very important to explain why it is really so and what are our arguments to explain why such a decision was made. Traditional ethics has a lot of things to say about big data, and in general, if you are trying to implement big data service or develop such a solution, you definitely need to understand what are the issues of what are the solutions which were provided by those philosophers and practitioners who dealt with similar problems before or started to think about this recently. So such books like Ethics of Big Data, Balancing Risk and Innovation by Davis Korda is a good initial reading anyway. So what are the interesting things which we can find from such books? First of all, big data is ethically neutral, and important elements of ethics in relation to big data are identity, privacy, ownership of data, and reputation of those who supply and consume the data, and own the data, actually. What is also very important is that privacy, in many cases, are not rights, but in many cases are interests. It means that you need to balance your or somebody's privacy rights or privacy interests with similar interests of another participants. Identity. Became an important because in many cases we collect information related to a huge number of people and behavior of people while supplying such information, say voluntarily supplying or in some cases supplying according to some regulation, may be very different. And we know that in many cases, or at least in some cases, people tend to use several identities while browsing through internet or accessing different services. That's a big problem, and some people think that this is a future of identity in general, and some people think that that's simply lack of integrity. And probably those who deal with or develop social networks or something like this think that it's a lack of integrity and think that to the end of the day, people will continue with this one and the same general identity. Nevertheless, they use it in real life or in internet. On the other hand, it's a problem of privacy. And privacy is also an interesting thing because probably when internet appeared and even when it became very popular thing, say 15 years ago, 20 years ago, there were a lot of opportunities for people not to disclose their private data or just limit disclosure of private data in the internet even more than it was possible in real life. But currently, with the appearance of big data sets and ability to mine these data sets, it became not so possible. Probably 20 years ago in one popular journal magazine, there was a joke about nobody can ensure that in the internet that you are a dog. And currently it's possible not only ensure that you are a dog, but which dog exactly, what do you like, and so on. So it's still not clear how will identity and privacy will evolve in recent years, and this can still, I think, will be impacted by decisions which are made in specific countries regarding to specific situations, because, say, overregulation can cause attempt of people to resist and to use multiple identities or something like this. Responsible ownership is another very important thing. And reputation also changed significantly because it much less depends currently on people you know personally, deal daily, and so much less under your control than it was ever before. At the same time, reputation management became much more important and popular thing for a huge number of people than it ever was. It was probably a problem for people in the world of politics, but now it's, or probably in some business, but now it's very, very common thing for everybody. And there are a lot of benefits to asking these questions directly and attempting to receive answers, at least for business, because you can avoid a lot of problems with regulation and with customers, and not to fall in the situation when your business can be blocked completely. But we in our discussion, or probably I in my discussion, wanted to go a bit further and to discuss more technical issues, rapidly coming from general discussion to much more technical discussion, because we need some more technical, probably more formal and more practical instruments to incorporate ethical behavior into what we are doing in technically. And what we expect from such technical or such theoretical approaches. We need, if it's possible, formal rules to classify steps we take or systems take as being right and wrong, to ensure that this is consistent, to verify whether our steps in line with existing regulation, and in some cases check whether the regulation is self-consistent or not. It's very typical that it will be not self-consistent. And we need to apply these rules in a consistent way to information systems which involve big data. And we need to understand how to deal with this data which have certain level of autonomy. So it's not mostly not about robotics, like a known theory or approach to how people should behave while developing system. It's mostly about what we should implement into online services implying big data to force them to operate reasonably. Just a list of approaches I wanted to cover in a minute. Most fundamental approaches are information logic by Luciano Floridi, information accountability as it was proposed by the team from V3C and MIC, deontic logic, which is very much classical thing, useful in ethical discussions, universal moral grammar, auto-reflexive models of conflict and cooperation, differential privacy, pretty much popular topic in Microsoft research, I think, and a lot of more specific calculi languages and so on. And the basis for all this is a category theory. In many cases, it's also one another not related directly to privacy, but also very interesting topic and important in practical solutions is the computation on encrypted data. You will find some useful references that I can provide much more if somebody will be interested in specific topics later. I will try to link some of these practical approaches or mathematical approaches to specific problems in big data scenarios a bit later, but the first thing, due to its very fundamental nature, should be probably covered before I will discuss any specific scenario. It's an information ethics. I will probably skip details and say only that there was an evolution of ethical approaches from ancient times to modern days. And in nature, ethics nevertheless which approach actually we implement is some sort of information exchange which involves actors and patients, which has a context and so on, and which has actually the message which is information in nature from actor to subject, to patient. Scope of application of ethics was evolving and growing with time from old times when only the citizens of Athens or Rome were people whose rights were respected fundamentally, to understanding that all humans are equal in their rights and should be treated equally. And nevertheless, this was also agent-oriented, as it was mostly discussion about active side of ethical relations, then to more general understanding that we should respect some at least minimal rights of not only human beings, but say be ethical in relation to animals and in general to support biological diversity or something like this, then to fundamental ecological approach. And to respecting rights of very different from us objects in general, and up to what is currently important to infosphere in general, and we should understand that we also need to extend moral norms to those objects which are in general informational objects. Luciano Floridi discussed a lot what does it mean to be moral patient, so the subject, the object of ethical act. And in general, we have very little arguments to say that abstract chunks of information cannot be subject of such relations. And we even can extend, probably can provide some arguments why there is a link between traditional terms and understanding of moral norms and some informational things like general information or entropy. I'm not sure which exactly definition or which exactly interpretation of entropy should be used when we speak about informational form of ethical principles, but nevertheless, it's more or less understandable that it can be a problem when you destroy a set of information somewhere in computer system because it may have somehow similar results to what can happen when you destroy something in real life or kill somebody in real life. There are evident conclusions for big data architecturing and handling because we understand that many sets or subsets of big data can be treated as moral patients. We then have more arguments to say that our rights to use, collect, destroy information, or to handle our own personal data, personal information, are somehow restricted not only in relation to other persons, to other humans, but also to information objects which were derived from this information somehow. So it sometimes can be a problem to destroy a set of information which relates to, say, to me and some information system for many reasons. And one of practical reasons is if we allow everybody to or somebody to kill directly, randomly kill some parts of information in big data set, then any attempt to make any sort of analytics over such big data set can become questionable very much. So anyway, this should be regulated, and we should be prepared to the fact that we should from the very beginning to architect our systems in the way that we respect rights of information objects we plan to put into this big data sets. What are the sources for big data real-life applications? First of all, of course, these are humans. And at least in developed countries, humans produce a lot of information just because they do something actively or because they do something passively, because simply they write electronic mails, they make a phone calls, they visit physicians, they fall into the areas controlled by video recording systems, or just go somewhere near feed systems, and so on, so on, so on. And even your mouse in the computer, or touchpad if you use it, can say provide a lot of information to computer regarding your mental situation right now. Are you frustrated? Are you tired? Or are you happy this moment, or something like this? When you have a lot of information to analyze, such data provided by different sources can be very, very rich. And at least most of other people have phones, mostly cell phones. Data as well are the sources of information, some because they are active and participate in some sort of network relations like sensors with operating systems and communication models, and some are simply passively because they can be identified by context. Today, the world still is human dominated because there are more people than devices. But in a few years, the situation will change dramatically. There will be much more devices with much more identifiable objects than humans. We need to live in this world and to understand what to do with these things and somehow to respect their rights as well. In general, if we speak about who are actors subjects and objects for big data systems, or big data services, we can say that these are humans, which are unique by default. These are real world identifiable objects because they are active, they are passive but identified by context. There are some things which arise which are in between, like pets with feeds, or pets in wild nature which are identifiable by context again, content again. There are in some future artificial intelligence agents. And these are abstract objects, shadows of all these objects, or probably newly developed things which have no analog in real life, which reside and live somehow in informational systems in big data sets. And they're important as well. So the scenarios to which can be applied some ethical norms and mathematics behind them are probably like something like this. It's not a complete scenario, it's a parts of scenarios which have different requirements and different, probably different way of treating. This is processing, mostly MapReduce from vast majority of all big data related operations. This is a pieces of data, and in most situations, again, this is something like key value, but key and value can be rather complicated structures. This is upstream when people or devices supply information to a centrally managed, nevertheless actually distributed and parallel systems, but in general supplied to somewhere where they are stored, processed, and somehow managed by some specific body. This is downstream where people or devices extract some information related to them or their relatives, or just receive some specific not related to anybody in particular information from these services simply because they consume the service. That's a lot of social interactions. That's for the first, very important for social networks, for social services as we know them, like Facebook and a lot of others. But at the same time, this is very important for architecture of big data sets because a lot of big data assets are in general very complicated graph structures. When we need or want to receive something useful from the data we collected, that's a predictive analytics. And there are a lot of mathematical methods, which a lot of models, which should be and can be used while you attempt to predict something. And as you remember from the definition of big data, you cannot do a lot of useful things with big data if you do not have some sort of predictive analytics, because initially the structure and behavior of data inside big data sets are not clear and by default is not known. Consolidation. It's when you are trying to collect all or majority of all data which cover some specific area, like say everything related to air flights in the world or something like this. Aggregation, when you are trying to extract some specific intensive or extensive characteristics of such a set of information which covers specific area. Depersonalization and de-identification, when the data which can be provided to somebody who requests such an information should not violate somebody's privacy rights. And privacy for the purposes of open data, big data in many cases means any data generated by identifiable objects, by say specific human or by any specifically identified device or something like this. So depersonalization in many cases is required for open data. Open data is somehow important but limited concept, and I will hope be able to speak a few minutes about this a bit later. Repersonalization and re-identification, that's a vice versa process when somebody is trying to obtain personally identifiable information from the set which initially assumed to be depersonalized. There were a lot of examples when it was shown that in some practical cases this is still possible, especially with medical records. Is it always illegal or not? That's a question which has very important ethical value. And also there are new scenarios of data leaking which associated specifically with big data and we never faced before. At somewhere at the end of the presentation I will speak a few probably seconds about what is the scenario which is specific for big data and how to fight with it. And digital forensics, when we have a huge governmentally managed or private companies managed sets of data, it's often very helpful from the point of view of traditional justice to ask questions about something which is stored in such big data sets. What are the ruling which can be applied to such a situations and what is acceptable, what is not, while you are dealing with big data sets for the purposes of digital forensics. Mass and some legal. I wanted to put here something like legal disclaimer, but then decided that I have to put something like mathematical disclaimer, saying not only that all legal statements can be wrong in the presentation, you need to seek professional legal advisor, but also say that all equations are wrong and you need to seek professional mathematician advisors as well, so I've decided to omit this slide. What's about processing of big data? Definitely, as it was already mentioned for many times before me and by much more professional experts during this call, in many cases this is a MapReduce operation, so a set of and somehow uniform operations. What makes them universal enough is in many cases these operations in regarding to specific chunk of information are commutative and associative. And this, along with some other ideas related to types and so on, brings us to the idea to use mathematical theory of categories as a general language, high-level language, to describing such a situation. The picture is only for illustrations, no mathematical sense behind it in general. But if we think about somehow high-level theory of such architectures and such processes as something can be is about something which can be described in terms of category theory, then we can try to find what techniques known for category theory we can use. And say probably we can think about using of Haskell or something like this in this context on one hand, and on another hand we can try to search for those problems which already were described in terms of theory of categories, and to ask whether we can use MapReduce techniques to solve these problems in practice if there was demonstrations that mathematically they can be described in this way. I will not try to say what is category, but in general, the main, and probably you know from the mathematical courses, and probably the main idea is that we can think about categories like about combination of some abstract objects and some operations which are sort of something like in trivial case functions from one set to another, but in much more general, much more abstract way. And, but some general ideas like associativity or specific of some basic operations are still inherited from the main ideas. Unexpectedly, and it was happened for many times in mathematics during last several hundred years, unexpectedly, this theory, like theory of groups or some mathematical analysis or something before this, occurred to be very, very useful in very different areas of science outside of mathematics or inside mathematics. It's very popular right now, and theory of categories impacts very much everything, starting from quantum mechanics and string theory, and up to theory of workflows in big companies, or something like this. As well as very important for mathematical areas like topology or mathematical logic and so on. It just came to mind of two very clever mathematicians to write an overview article which they even titled Rosetta Stone, and just demonstrated that there are a lot of similarity in different areas. Some of these areas are really very interesting. See, theory of categories impacted quantum mechanics very seriously. And it was just shown that you can, to a certain degree, throw away those things you probably know from university courses like Hilbert space or something like this, and just talk about operations and transformations between different states, not paying too much attention to what is the nature of the state actually. So any mathematical structure which attempts to describe the details of how the state of the system is arranged are somehow not very important in such an approach. And this very practical and very nice, but a bit unusual for still for many scientists right now, approach to quantum mechanics is very helpful while you are trying to build something like to deal with quantum information system or trying to describe architecture for quantum computing. So you see that there are a lot of links between mathematics, between physics, between architecture of computers, modern or future, and so on. What was for some cases, for some interesting reason, missed in this story is applications to mathematical linguistics. That's especially funny because one of the authors of this article was at that time just in transition to Google Research. So, something is really missed. And does it have any relation to ethics? Yes, I will show. A bit step aside. There is a well-known discussion, I think partially jokely, partially serious, between what is the right approach not only to mathematical linguistics and shallow search systems, but as well to science in general. Because some people think that you need to have beautiful, simple theory with the simple structures, and you can explain the world with the help of this. It's a very much Einstein-style approach. And some others believe that if you have a lot of data, you can use some general sort of statistics and to derive the right rules, or probably to predict, even without rules, the behavior of the system, of the nature in general, just because you have enough data. Probably the most known person who currently supports the first approach, at least in mathematical linguistics and outside mathematical linguistics, is Noam Chomsky, I think one of the most known scientists in general in the world. There was a discussion, some discussion which was and still is discussed in the minds of many people around the world, happened not so far ago during the MIT honorable anniversary session. And the opponent was, or probably later after this session, was Peter Norvig, who one of the most respected scientists in the area of artificial intelligence and director for research for Google. They still support different approaches, or at least think that balance should be different. Can the balance really be achieved? It's a question. In general, it's possible to say that linguistics evaluated and matured with time in several directions, never existing separately, but somehow interacting between. But anyway, there was a structural approach and statistical approach, almost, or probably data-based approach, during most part of the history of linguistics in general. Both first grammars, first theoretical grammars, and first vocabularies arrived centuries years ago. Even ideas like bag of words in search and bag of senses in relation to cognitive science and understanding of human nature are relatively old right now. Now I will try to say how they can be merged. Probably one of the most prominent, at least from my point of view, prominent approaches to merging of these two worlds came from a bit unexpected area, from researching category theory, especially of closed monoidal categories, and were mostly developed by an active team of researchers in Oxford University. And you can find all these articles easily and read. They are pretty much readable, so it's very interesting to see how abstract mathematics can be used in such a situation like quantum mechanics or theoretical linguistics. So they developed a lot of unified approaches and the very nice techniques which they call picturalism, simply because it used very simple pictures to explain complicated structures, a bit like Feynman did with his diagrams for path integration. On one hand, this team wrote articles like Quantum Mechanics for Children, and on the other hand, they developed very nice approaches to mathematical linguistics. In general, there was a long tradition of making structural approach to linguistics simpler and simpler and simpler. And probably the most prominent impact to this area was done by Noam Chomsky when he found that there exists a universal structure for all languages, and languages are governed by by a little number of parameters, like probably a bit more than 100. And if you change one parameter, you receive different language. And most languages, there are a large variety of languages, but their differences can be described in a very compressed form through just changing of a few parameters. So there is a natural structure of all languages, which is pretty much mathematical. So this is what is called universal grammar, universal linguistic grammar. That was done along with introduction of mathematical structures for syntactical analysis of sentences. Then there were several attempts to make these structures, approaches to describing such structures simpler, simpler, and simpler. This is called minimalism approach. And currently we have very useful and relatively simple ways to describe the structure of any sentence, or probably a group of sentences. What was missed from, and first computer systems which attempted to, say, translate from one language to another was built mostly on such an approach. What was completely missed is the semantics of particular words or groups of words, because for many words, their sense is actually not what the words is itself, but probably the typical context of usage of the word. That is what is very well catched by statistical methods and statistical approaches, but completely lost in structural linguistic approaches. So we have on one hand structural linguistics, which is in some cases very important, because you know that even punctuation can change the sense of the sentence completely. But on the other hand, it is well known that, say, for English language and I think for Russian language, approximately about 80% of one information depends on words and does not depend on their order at all. And there are even languages which are fundamentally has no order of words in the sentence. So you can put words in any random order you prefer, and nevertheless you will receive a syntactically correct sentence. But not always. And this not always is very important, because if we do not take one or another approach into account, then we do not receive really correct results, and at least our systems still remain probably more or less satisfying us in situation of shallow internet search, but definitely not enough for real understanding of the language. So what was done by the team is Bob Koecki and his co-authors in Oxford, they found that using a theory of categories, which allows us to make morphisms between abstract structures, they can build a sort of structure of space, which is actually external multiplication of the probability space belonging to probability model and structural space belonging to structural model. The same way as we could do it for structural linguistic description. So we currently have something very nice which combine in the very simple way both these approaches, and theoretically we can have a unified and simple mathematical model which describes both aspects of language. How it relates to ethics we shall see in a few minutes. Well, this is important. Say when when we have such a problem like regulation written by people somewhere in parliament, on one hand, say relating to taxation or something like this. On the other hand, we have business applications which need to follow this regulation. We need to translate natural language legislation to some sort of machine-readable language like XBRL or something like this, and we need to translate one to another. So it's important to have to take into account formal structure. It's important to take into account meanings. It's important to utilize ontologies for terms which have specific meaning in terms of regulation or in terms of area of application of the system. We can benefit highly from having mathematically uniform and advanced mechanism to describe such a situation. I will not probably discuss in details what are the problems with data. Okay, let's omit it. What are the problems with upstream, so with people supplying information? The problem is supply is currently huge, even if we talk only about humans. Say about 1 billion people which supply something to Facebook, and a lot of devices which supply information also. When people supply, they tend to have much more flex with their personal data than some theoretician could expect. And seems that we cannot do anything with this. This is a new pattern, not a bug. It's a feature of such a service and a feature of our life, and probably we shall have to live with this forever. We can try, of course, to prohibit social services, but it will cause only frustration and nothing else. Also, we have a lot of problems with devices which supply more and more information. This is, in many cases, questionable. A lot of interesting problems arise. I just put here quotation from a recent publication, probably a few days ago. It's about a new information system which should be implemented in Moscow subway. It will track all the SIM cards of all mobile phones of all people who use subway. It's a bit questionable from a juristical point of view, because some people think, and at least I also think, that this is a personal data, but the official from Ministry of Internal Affairs who explained why this system can be implemented told an interesting thing. He said that it was, of course, illegal to track a person without permission from the authorities, but that there was no law against tracking the property of a company, such as SIM card. That's probably a very funny approach. And at least we need to deal with such a problems a lot in the near future. And if we implement such a system, say for national security purposes, which is for sure a very valuable opportunity, and in my opinion should be supported. But then we shall face also not only questions about how such a system should be used from legal point of view, but also we shall face a sophisticated approaches to compromise the systems and to avoid the control built into such a systems. And using multiple SIM cards is only the simplest approach, which currently is already invoked by criminals and so on, but probably we shall see much more sophisticated approaches soon. Why people are so ready to supply anything about themselves to social services? Because they receive what they need in exchange. They consider the service valuable, and they trust the service and consider it reputable and responsible. The same with governmental systems. People support the idea to use social security or taxation systems if they consider them effective, and if they trust the administration. So it's possible to say that personal data and data in general is a new currency or new tax for the world of information technologies. And if there is a lack in value, effectiveness, or trust, then there is a risk of economic slowdown and social frustration in the country. Supply and identity. Okay, let's skip it. What's about downstream? There are generally many questions, but most important in this situation, who is allowed to retrieve data, and what are the quality of results? Are they complete and accurate or not? So responsible usage, who is allowed to retrieve the data? If you've been an expert in information security, belonging to old school, say, to probably the answer would be nobody, never, nothing, at least by default. But with the systems which prohibit everything by default, we can live in a few situations. Say, in some bureaucratically well-organized and hierarchical small to medium-sized organizations. It's hard to imagine that a service with a billion users and with different scenarios of usage can follow such an approach. So probably the more important thing is information accountability and responsibility. And it means that we should rather inform those who want to consume some information about how it should be done, what are obligations related to consumption of the information, and at least how somebody violating these rules can be prosecuted. If we try to formalize the requirements to usage of such a system, and if we wanted to avoid the situation that we stick with a pure role-based access models, access rights models, and we wanted to allow more or less broad set of actions, never the same, putting some obligations to everybody who consumes the information, we should use some mathematical models. And a good model for this, probably not the most general, is deontic logic, a part of formal logic, which deals with real and ideal situations and with terminology like permissible, impermissible, admissible, optional, and so on. In brief, we can say that there are a bit more relations than in ordinary logic, but it well can be described in terms of obligations, permissions, and prohibitions. So something is obligatory, something is permissible, something is forbidden. And interpretations of how sentences can be changed between these approaches. Using such an approach, it is possible, not without some paradoxes, of course, to formalize questions regarding ownership and usage of intellectual property, in general property in information systems, about privacy and data protection, about equal access or equal prohibition to access to information, and about responsibility related to pieces of information and to formalize this. So it's a good idea to have some general understanding of such a terminology when you are planning to implement the system of access rights or the system of management of scenarios while dealing with personal data in big data assets. There are rather sophisticated scenarios with obligations, say, in a system which deals somehow with personal data related to children. In most countries, there are requirements that first you need to receive permission from parents, you need to verify it, then you may process your operation related to personal data of a child, then you cannot do any other such operations during predefined period of time, then you should check something related to this during the year and so on. This is what can be described in models like PeerBug or something like this using deontic logic. Social interaction. Not in all, but in many big data sets, the many most largest and most complicated big data sets, social structures are very important. Yeah. Oh, I'm out of time. Okay. So, I need to be very fast. What is interesting? We can have similar structures related to ethics, which looks very much like the same structures in linguistics. That's a deep idea which allows us to describe social interactions and ethical aspects of interaction, as it's led to an idea of, actually belonging to Michael, idea of developing universal moral grammar similar to universal linguistic grammar developed by Komsky. That's still work in progress, but it allows us to have at least well-describable algorithms of solving complicated ethical situations, which we can already implement into some systems. Okay, about analytics, what we can say. Sometimes we need to ask specific questions related to cooperation or conflict scenarios. And this is actually the question that, which Michael asked. What is the diversity of moral grammar situations similar to diversity of languages? The answer probably was provided, at least partially provided, by well-known in Russia, but not very well-known abroad, nevertheless living in the United States for many years, scientist Vladimir Lefebvre, who proposed a nice after-reflection model of conflicts and cooperation scenarios with a nice mathematics which partially derived from Boolean algebra, partially inspired by category theory again, at least in Notion. I will not say about any details. About leaking, probably one of the last things. The reason of grand leaking during some last years, probably a few last years, is partially has some relation to big data, because before the era of big data, there were no big storages for all the information, all non-structured information, say all text you have in company or in governmental organization. When there were first attempts to build such a systems and to try to make a deep analysis of huge sets of information, people started to design the systems in a way, please bring all the information, all your ideas, all something you just feel and not sure about to some central storage. Then we shall use one account to access this information, to analyze this, and to make some decisions. And this was a big weak aspect of architecture of such a system. So having access to the whole system, the whole bunch of information from one account was the huge problems for leaking over hundreds of thousands of documents. At the same time, all the each document in particular had no sense simply because many of these documents are something which somebody was thinking or not sure about or even know that it's not the truth, and it could play a role of a document in a reference set of documents which is needed to prove that something is wrong, but when it's leaked and published, it caused a lot of frustration from people who do not understand the architecture of such a systems. Then what I would like to say, there are a lot of approaches to avoid such as such as situations, and partially it's related to the situations of day and rare personalization and mechanisms which allows you ask questions on a big set of big data without the need to statically depersonalize this data, simply because after static depersonalization you cannot answer most questions and have to stick with only predefined reports. To avoid this, we need some more complicated mathematical structure, which is differential privacy. But I will not drill into the topic at all because I'm out of time. So you see, there are a lot of questions which somehow relate to mathematical ethics right now and which should be implemented into real-life systems. But at the same time, it's a wonderful mathematics, and I think that nevertheless, you intend to develop something practical and to code the system for practical use right now, or you think about career of in pure mathematics, you can find a lot of interesting things in this area. And it definitely will be of interest for a lot of people. So I think it's of real interest. So thank you very much for listening. And I'm ready to answer some questions or to provide any additional links if you will be interested. Thank you.